Testing, 1, 2, testing, 1, 2.
Thank you. Test, test, 1, 2.
Test, test, 1, 2. Okay, so I'll use this.
Test, test, 1, 2, test, test, 1, 2. Doesn't. How much?
I just need Google Chrome, and I just need to open the tabs and make them their own window things. Is yours in QuickTime Player?
Yeah.
Okay, that's one of the things that's open. Oh, I need my Google Drive. Mr. That's what I asked Mr. Glassman. That's what he said. He said we're all going to be using the same computer. No, but it's in my drive. No, the marine videos things I shared with you. I didn't post it. I'm just going to slide over to it and play it. Because we have videos and then these videos need to have
we're almost there.
Okay. So what I have on my note cards, no, it's a slide right here.
Can we get started?
Well, it should be fully downloaded by the time he goes up. He's going up in 40 minutes.
You guys can come fill in if you'd like. Okay, hi everyone. Welcome to Fall Demo Day. This is the culminating event for our Fall Venture Incubator, where our brave students have spent the last 3 months, working on business plans. A couple nonprofit, mostly for-profit this go around. And this is their chance to share with our panel of judges and members of our community and their parents and their friends all the hard work they've done. For those of you that don't know me, I'm Ed Glassman. I'm the director of the Center for Entrepreneurial Leadership here at SCH Academy. And we do a lot of really exciting things in this program, but I have to admit this is my favorite. This is real entrepreneurship happening with students that are young and eager to change the world. So it's an inspiring opportunity for myself and our mentors and Ms. Stokes to work with your sons and your daughters every afternoon here in CEL. Before we introduce our first entrepreneur, our only middle school entrepreneur of the evening, I'd like to give a few thank yous. So first and foremost, the way this program works is every student is assigned a mentor, an industry professional that has some sort of experience in the vein of what they're working on. So I want to thank our mentors. I'd like to thank Ms. D. Bernadidas, Rini to me. I'd like to thank Parth, who's somewhere around here. Thank you, Parth. Logan, who's watching us through the live stream, hopefully, and Jack Kelly as well. I'd like to thank Mark Greenberg over here. Deidre, where are you, Deidre? Hi, Deidre. Drew, who's also watching through the live stream, and Kristen and Mindy. Without you guys, this program doesn't work, and we so appreciate your time. That's more than enough from me. Now it's time to introduce our first entrepreneur. So I'd like to ask Rini to come to the stage and introduce Grant.
Hi there. So this is actually...
Sorry. I forgot a really important thing. Sorry about that. So one thing I forgot is I like to try to highlight students that have gone through this program in the past and are continuing work on their ventures. So last year, I started working with Caroline on a new program that we call SCH miniTHON, which raises money for pediatric cancer research. And she and her team, Jesse and Jolly, are gonna give us a quick update before we hear from Grant. Okay, sorry again about that. Why don't you guys come up to the stage? Sorry.
It's okay. First, we're going to show a video about what our project is about.
Thank you. Jolly Hendricks.
I'm Caroline Clark.
And I'm Jesse Bowser, and we are SCH Minithon. Our event is a 10-hour on-your-feet dance marathon. We will be holding our event on February 24th, 2017, in the Kingsley Gymnasium on the Willowgrove campus.
Our event is a nonprofit event, and all of the funds that we raise go to the Four Diamonds Fund, which is located in Hershey, PA. And we've been working on this event since September, and this week we're starting registration. So to kick off registration, we're having an event at Iron Hill Brewery where 20% of every one of our checks comes back to SCH Minithon. So these papers were in your packets, and we're inviting everyone to come next Monday on December 19th at Iron Hill. It's all day, so from the time they open to the time we close, if you just give them this form, you can come and all the money, well, 20% of your check will come back to SCH Minithon.
So all money donated from our events will go to the Four Diamonds Foundation, as she said. And so with the 95 cents of every dollar donated, that money directly impacts children overcoming childhood cancer. It covers their medical bills 100%. And with the other 5 cents of that dollar, it goes to finding the cure of cancer. So for any extra info about registration or buying or donating and buying a swag that we have, which consists of wristbands and lanyards, you can email us at schminithon@gmail.com.
Thank you.
Okay, now I'd like to ask Rainey D. Bernadetis to come to the stage.
Well, that's worth being interrupted for. Hopefully we can all support their efforts. That's great. So I'm here to introduce Grant Guzik, again, the sixth grader and the youngest member of our Venture Incubator team. This is actually the second time I've had the pleasure of seeing Grant turn his passion for animals into action. So last year, as part of our Reading Olympics program, Grant initiated and helped organize a trip to the local animal shelter. And he recruited some of his teammates to go and read to the cats and dogs who live at the shelter. And as Grant explained to us that by having us, people read to the cats and dogs there, it helps acclimate the shelter animals to humans, which makes it easier for them to get adopted. So who knew? So I learned from Grant last year. And thanks again for teaching me tons about animals this year with his Venture Incubator work around marine animals. And I'm so glad you're all going to get to hear Grant's awesome ideas around the issue of protecting marine animals. So please welcome Grant.
Good afternoon. Start things off by raise of hand. Who has ever been to a New Jersey beach or shore? Also by raise of hand, who has ever seen or has known someone who has seen a stranded marine animal at the beach? Whether you have or whether you haven't, listen up. WeCoastMarine, families uniting for marine animal safety. WeCoastMarine is a nonprofit organization that is raising awareness for the struggles of marine animals to kids and families. I am focusing on kids and families because they can help provide support and become future environmentalists, helping protect the ocean, protect the animals, and protect themselves. Today I'll be showing off my business, which is WeCoastMarine, our website and our camps, which are our two main solutions. The big problem is that marine animals are dying at an alarming rate. And this is happening because not enough people know that these animals are getting stranded, and people aren't knowledgeable enough that these animals are, let me rephrase that. People aren't knowledgeable enough the harm they are causing to these animals to the ocean. Some examples for this could be when they're fishing, when they're boating, or even throwing something away in the trash. In my research for this problem, I found a video of a sea turtle who had a plastic soda straw up its nose. So this just shows you how people aren't thinking before they're throwing something away. about the marine animals. And also a really big problem that contributes to the problem, or part that contributes, is there's no federal funding towards some marine animal organizations that are providing help to marine animals. So WeCoastMarine offers two solutions. One of our solutions is a website, which is a year-long way for kids and families to learn about WeCoastMarine, learn about the marine animals, learn what they can do to help. This also kind of helps the camps out because it has a blog for campers to share their experiences, so more and more families and kids can come back every year. And our camps, they are marine biology camps, so the kids can learn about marine animals in general, and they will also learn about what they can do to help them, how to make sure that they're going to protect the ocean and protect the animals. These camps are going to be run by expertise from the closest marine mammal organization to the beach that the camps are going to be at. So, for example, if we were at a Bridgeton beach, most likely I would get expertise from the Marine Mammal Stranding Center to run the camp and to teach these kids. And these camps work because they're really convenient for the kids and families. They're really convenient because they're reasonably priced, they're going to be really close to where the kids and families are vacationing to, and they're going to be at reasonable times that fit the family schedule. And for our website, it isn't a complete product yet, it's not finished, but this is just the homepage. And as I mentioned, one of the problems, there is no federal or government funding. So what I did is I have a page that gives most of the government officials from New Jersey. And if you might wondering why I put like the certain districts, those are the districts that are closest to New Jersey coastline, which is why I'm focusing on. And I eventually go bigger. WeCoastMarine's main target customers would be families and kids who are vacationing to the New Jersey shores and beaches. Most likely, I would want them to vacation very often, at least once a year. And the kids should be ages 8 and up so they can handle the camps. And the families don't have to be, but it would be really good if they were recruited from marketing through New Jersey Shore Realtors. And what I mean by this is when you're renting a beach house to stay at the shore, you might get an info packet from the realtors that you set it up with. And I could put a brochure of my company or a packet of a flyer about my company so they can learn about my camps, learn about my company, and learn all that we do to try to help marine animals. And I'm doing interviews. I started with my school, so basically what the interviews are, I'm asking a couple questions about their experiences at the beach. So the main question I'm going to ask, as you're going to see soon, is have you ever seen a stranded marine animal? And whether they answer yes or no, if they answer yes, I would say, did you know what to do? How did you approach the situation? If they answered no, I would say, would you know how to approach the situation? So here's just the shortest interview I had. Oh, no audio. Still no audio. Okay, so what I remember of what he said was that he hasn't seen a marine animal. And when I asked him, would you know what to do, he said he wouldn't know what to do personally, but he would call the closest expertise from the closest organization. He even mentioned the Marine Mammal Stranding Center, which he said he had visited. And also, what I also said is that I would really recommend calling the expertise first, because you don't know if it's going to be an aggressive animal or not. Even if it's turtle, even though, wow, it's turtle, it's going to be calm, it could still be very aggressive towards you. People would want our solutions. Start off with the camps. They offer a fun new learning experience for the kids. And if they're going to vacation to the ocean, it would make sense that they love it. So this is a contributor. So that's why people would want the camps, because they're learning about the ocean that they're vacationing to. And they would want the website, because people can learn about the camps, learn what they can do to help these marine animals, how they contribute to the cause and the problem that I'm trying to solve. Okay, let's talk money. WeCoastMarine's revenues, or how we make money, the main one is camp fees. And for now, they're at $50 for a five-person family, so that means it's $10 for each person. And this could be counted as a donation, which is also a revenue that we have. And these donations would go to the Marine Mammal Stranding Center and other organizations along the New Jersey coastline to help out the marine animals cause. What we lose money from is also we're going to have to get all the materials needed for these camps and also for advertising. As you may know, companies, they have to pay a little bit of amount of money to have their commercial shown, to have the commercial put onto like a music station, for example. So that would cost us some money to do. And also, I would have to travel to the camps to be there to teach people about WeCoastMarine from the main person who created it, not trying to be selfish or anything. And what it means by travel is it could be the gas mileage, the gas, engine problems for the car that I'm going to be traveling in to get to the camps. It would really help me out if you cared enough to help kickstart off WeCoastMarine. And you could do this by little things like financial support. You could give the first donation, sponsorship, government funding to help out with the problem and with the cause. Also, you can do another little thing. Just spread the word. As soon as you get home, probably, you can tell your family about it, tell your friends about it. This would really help me out. I would really like to thank a couple people. The main person is my mentor, Mrs. D. She really helped me out stay focused on the main thing. She really helped me stay focused on the main thing, so I stayed on one main thing to focus on for my business, so I didn't go too off topic and not know what to say today. Also, Mr. Glassman and Mrs. Stokes, and Ms. Stokes, they helped me all year long get ready for demo day, get my presentation together, my website together, and everything that helped. And also my parents, at the end of my business, not trying to make them sound bad or anything, at the end, they really helped me out with all the work that I had to do to get my website going, get my presentation going. So I'd really like to thank all those people. Thank you for listening. Are there any questions or suggestions you may have?
Okay, after each presentation, we're going to take some questions from our esteemed panel of judges. And we're also trying something a little new this year. I've invited two of our students, Emma and Fred, the student judges. So many of these businesses have people our students' age as their target customer. So it seemed only right to invite some students to give feedback. So do any of our judges have questions or comments they'd like to ask?
Sounds like a very good idea.
Thank you.
And good for you for coming up with it. I'm interested to know how much money you think you'll need, because I thought I heard you say that the revenues from the camps would be devoted to other nonprofits, and yet you've got a whole bunch of expenses. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering, as this grows, how much it might need in terms of donations from governments, individuals, and foundations.
Yeah, I don't know exactly the starting amount of money I'd need, but I'd say it would be at least like $50 to $100. Not because it's not for my personals. It's for to help out the marine animals cause, help out my business, and so I could start the camps as soon as possible so that I could help out the kids and the families learn about the marine animals and my business. You're welcome.
So great job, Grant.
Thank you.
That was really well done. I have a question for you. So who will be staffing the camps, and how will you recruit those people?
The people that will be staffing the camps are expertise from the closest marine animal organization. And I would recruit these people before the camps would be held. I could contact them. I could go there I could go there physically, or I could call them, email them, to ask if they would be willing enough to supply some of their staff to help me out.
Sixth grade, right?
Yeah.
Well, first of all, let me commend you on your presentation. I have a sixth and a seventh grader at home, and I think you did a heck of a job. You know, you're talking about families that are vacationing, right? Maybe a week, a Saturday to Saturday mm-hmm. type of thing. What's the length of a particular camp?
Well, the camps would be around 2 hours. Mm-hmm. And the only thing that would vary with the camps is that it would be one every week. For now, it would be one every week. And the day would change every week. So 1 week, it could be on a Saturday from 9 to 11. So they'd be about 2 hours long. Mm-hmm. And the next week, this is for the summer, they could be on a Wednesday from 1 to 3
okay.
p.m.
Very good. And it was $10 a head, approximately?
$10 for each person. So that would be that's the starting price mm-hmm. that we're going to have.
Okay. And I don't want to get too far ahead of myself, but I can tell you that the summer camp programs are very big business mm-hmm. nowadays, whether they're offered by colleges and universities or even the Krinsky camps, which you may have heard of. But I think as your program continues to develop, you can probably charge more.
Mm-hmm. Thank
okay?
you.
Okay, sure.
Great job.
Thank you.
I have one thing that came to my mind as you were kind of going through your ideas regarding the camp, and something that stood out to me was the website that you had that you were going to have people interact with during the school year when they weren't at the beach.
Yeah.
Do you ever think maybe of using that as a learning tool that you can roll out to schools, like environmental science classes? And you can get, you know, 30 kids in a class, 70 kids in a day that maybe a teacher or an instructor can incorporate into their normal courses.
I never thought of that till you just said it, basically. So also with that being a question, it's a really good suggestion, so I'd like to thank you for that.
Sure.
But maybe eventually,
you could start
probably
with the coastal
we will.
Towns.
What?
You could start with the coastal towns.
Yeah.
And roll it out to the schools. And teachers usually love stuff that might positively augment their
more.
Curriculum for an hour one day during the school year.
Thank you.
First, I just want to say great presentation.
Thank
and
you.
I also love the cause you're working on. So good job.
Thank you.
And then I was just wondering, how would you make your program seem more appealing to the kids? Because it would be most likely the kids saying, oh, hey, parents, can I go to this camp? Rather than the parents pushing the kids towards it.
Probably what we're going to do when we're advertising the camps is, as you may know, companies, what they do is in their commercials, they, like for McDonald's, what they could do is in their commercials, they make the food look actually appealing. So maybe what we could do is we could put the most appealing parts of the camp. So maybe eventually what we could do is we could do like a little meet and greet. Maybe the closest organization, or if we're working the expertise, the staff that's supplying is going to be the MMSC. Maybe they could bring one of their sea turtles, for example, that they have that they're trying to help out. Maybe we can come and they can do a little meet and greet and learn about that animal and interact with it.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
We're moving on. Good job.
Thank you.
While they're setting up. Good afternoon, I'm Parth. For the last 2 months, I've been working with Bruce Interior as the CEL technology mentor. Bruce Interior are very dedicated, enterprising, and resourceful students here at Springside. The project they're undertaking that has the potential to change how the medical industry thinks, acts, and have a positive impact on the communications between the doctor and the patient and vice versa. They've had some interesting thoughts along the process, some things they didn't know they stumbled upon, and they realize there are challenges they'll have to face, but that has been part of their learning process, and they're doing an amazing job. I'd like to welcome them to talk more about the project.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Hongkai Wang, and I'm a junior at Springside Chestnut Hill Academy.
And I'm Yuzhe Tao. I'm also a junior.
And today, we're here to present our business, Oversea. And before we actually get into the introduction of our business, I'd like to show a small video clip from the James Bond movie, Spectre. Oh, apparently, the audio didn't work, so I'll kind of narrow it along. So in this scene, Q is injecting James Bond with a nanotechnology called Smart Blood. And a couple years ago, when we were watching this movie, this idea came to us, like, what if this kind of technology can be applied to patients that needs constant monitoring of their vitals? And we thought, okay, this idea is definitely worth looking into. And after some research and some entrepreneurship learning with Mr. Glassman, we realized that nanotechnology is still too far away from us. So we decided to stick to something that is really accessible and affordable by general public. So then we switch our focus to current wearable device, like the Apple Watch I'm wearing right now. So what Oversea actually is, so what we actually hope to do is we aim to create a system that can efficiently connect you and your doctor on a real-time basis, and also help your doctor to give a better evaluation of your situation, and also help yourself, the patient, to learn more about your current condition.
On the problem our healthcare industry is currently facing is efficiency. Sometimes it takes a long time for doctors to go to you when an emergency takes place. And in our case, we can reduce the response time by having the doctors alerted after a problem emerged.
And with those problems in mind, we came up with this solution. So our solution is a combination of a wearable device and an electronic medical database. And there are three pieces to it: a smartwatch, a smartphone, and our own database. So first, your smartwatch is going to collect all your vital signs. And for now, we'll be focused on heart rate. So the smartwatch will be collect the heart rate and then upload it to your smartphone. And directly, the smartphone is going to transfer all the data it have to our database. No information will be stored on your personal device for security concerns. And then from the database, your doctor will have real-time access to all of your vitals and your past history records. And to bring a little more, we decided to integrate your other past medical records into our database just for the sake of convenience. So every time you open our app, you have everything in front of you in this instance. And also to bring above and beyond, we also came up with the idea with auto alerts. So what auto alert does is after collecting your heart rate from Apple Watch, we're going to see if it's within the normal range of 60 until 100. And that range may vary, depends on the patient. So if it's within that range, everything's going perfectly fine. But if it's not, we're also going to see if it's above or below. And if it's below, we're going to send alerts to both the user and the doctors, and we're going to tell them something's wrong. And if that condition remains for a long time, we'll be contacting them again, and maybe also contact the emergency service to help reduce the response time of the emergency service. And when the heart rate is above, we can also check it out with the Apple Watch to see if the person's working out. Because if they're working out, that means the person is trying to improve its own condition. And that's very good. And we'll also record that into our database. But if the person is not working out, and we can definitely see that the patient is facing issues with its cardiovascular diseases. And then we'll also send an alert to both the doctor and the patient. And also, if that condition remains for a long time, we'll send an alert to emergency service as well. And as I say, we'll be focusing on Apple Watch for now.
And currently, for our target customers, we'll be focusing on seniors who have cardiovascular issues, because we believe that they will be the most people who are most benefit disconnected from our devices, because sometimes when emergency happens, doctors might need to respond as quick as possible to reduce the cost. Also, in the future, we would like to expand our target customers' range to people who are recently out of surgeries, also tech-savvy people who are interested in new technologies, and people who love to work out because we can monitor their heart rate. Also, we will start with some small institutions that that we believe their customers could be benefited from our database and service. And also, we want to start small. That's why we will focus on small institutions first. And as you can see, the potential market for our product is large, and it's still growing in the future. However, with a large market, we face plenty of competitors.
And among those competitors, we have a major competition from Preventive Solution. So what Preventive Solution provides is a medical monitoring service for seniors. And that's an example of their product. Their product is basically a sensor that will be taped up around your chest. And also, we'll be competing with other workout apps just because they're also collecting your heart rate and give you a pattern of your own workout history. But we're very unique in our own way. First, we connect the healthcare service and you with ease and efficiency due to our apps on the smartphone and our database. And also, you have no more trouble looking up your records since everything will be accessible through the database. And also, as I mentioned, our major competition, their product is basically a sensor you have to wear taped on your heart at constant. So what we think is a watch is more comfortable to wear than a tape around your chest, right? And more importantly, their product is not waterproof. So either while you're having a workout or when you go swimming or even just maybe you get it wet. So I think Apple Watch would definitely have an edge over them. And since also because it's based on Apple Watch, it's easier for us to do marketing and there will be more potential customer as well. And based on that, since we're now selling our own devices, we'll be focusing our revenue on the subscription model.
And here's a basic income statement for our company. We're forecasting that we could have around 1,000 target subscription at first, and we're thinking about charging them for $150 per year, which gives us a revenue of $150,000. And then below us, the expenses we would have. And for now, we will focus on research and development. That will give us a total expense of around $130,000 too, which ends up with a profit of $20,000. In the future, we would like to completely develop our app, and we will have a website where you can access and see your past medical history. And we will also provide prediction for your future health trend. Also, our database would give you like an average of other people's health records, which can actually provide you with predictions. We're also thinking about providing our very own wearable device, since it is the thing that inspired our project at first. We would try to achieve smart blood, the nanobots that can actually send more vital signs information to the database and have it reviewed by doctors. Also, it cannot be limited on your personal doctors. We can also have doctors from all around the world to actually help you examine your health and to provide more insight into your health.
And that's it. Thank you, guys. Mm-hmm. And also, I'd like to say special thanks to Ms. Spott, Mr. Glassman, and Ms. Stokes. They have helped us so much through the past few weeks, and we really learned a lot. And also, if you guys like to contact us, please do. And these are the contact information of me and Yuzhe. And thank you.
Thank you.
Questions?
So very nice job and very interesting idea. I have a couple questions, but I want to ask them really quick because I know other people have questions and we only have a little bit of time. So I guess the first question I wanted to ask you was, if we flip back, and I don't care if you do it on the slides or not, to your financial page, and I'm going to ask you this question because you're in 11th grade and I've seen a lot of successful businesses created by kids your age. I should say young men your age. So tell me about the salaries piece. I was a little confused on that. So $50,000 are our salaries for year one. Who does that include?
First of all, it will contain both of us. And secondly, it will probably going to extend into the people that will be hiring, especially at our very first stage. It will probably include other marketing people. And since we decide to start really small, we're probably not going to have like a lot of staffs. And that's why we put this number relatively small and very conservative on this page.
You feel like you might need some technical help and resources?
Oh, yes. And we categorize under R&D down there.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Thank you. My second question is one that I think you really have to think through in this, because unlike just a solo application where somebody has an Apple Watch on their arm and they're recording data on their own computer, you're basically sharing that over the public internet to get it to your servers and then sharing it again, once again, to get to medical service providers, correct? Mm-hmm. Have you guys done some research into the rules and regulations? Obviously, people feel that their privacy and as well as information they wouldn't want to be shared, so let's call that security, are very important. Have you guys put thought into those two things, privacy and security?
Oh, yeah, that's definitely. So for now, during the process of transferring data, everything will definitely be encrypted. And we'll definitely double confirmation when the user logs in, and there will be even more procedures for the doctors to log in to see your data, so we can know that your data is secure. And also, as I mentioned, no data will be stored on your personal device, because we all know how vulnerable the personal devices are nowadays. So your data will just be going through your phone and then go straight into our secured database to ensure the security of the information. Does that answer the question?
Yes.
Yep, thank you.
Thanks for a nice, crisp, quick presentation. I'm interested to know whether you've thought about whether there are liability issues involved, that if the wrong information gets transmitted or there are false alarms because not enough time or the measurements were wrong, whether or not you're subject to any liability. And if so, what the expense for that would be.
Okay. So are you referring to the auto alerts, like when contacting the emergencies?
Yeah.
Okay. So what we thought about when we first think about this is, yes, that will definitely be an issue, especially when the sensor is not as sensitive as we like them to be. And so what we came up with is we also be alerting the patient as well. So the patient will be using the interface on your Apple Watch, and it's going to give us feedback. And we're also going to consult them, like, do you need emergency service? So sometimes they can make the option. They have the option to contact the emergencies right through their smartwatch. And also, if that abnormality in their heart rate remains for a really long time, we actually kind of feel obligated to at least have someone check it out. So what we can do is we can expand our service maybe to their family members, so when this kind of emergency happens, their family members will be able to double confirm their current status, and that will kind of reduce a rate of false alarm.
I was concerned about misdiagnosis or procedures that weren't warranted being taken based upon this idea.
So for the measurements, we will probably try to do multiple trials after one abnormality take place to ensure that we have the correct diagnosis.
I have a quick question. You said that you were going to start with the heart. Yeah. Why did you pick the heart?
Because heart rate monitor is like really common in the market right now, and a lot of it. And also, we actually did a research on Apple Watch. Like around 30% of them are owned by people about 55 years old, and that a lot of people from that age are very easily affected by cardiovascular situations. And since Apple Watch happened to have the ability to monitor your heart rate, we think this would be the perfect starting point for us. And also for people about that age, they would be more likely to able to afford our service, and it would make more sense for us to start there.
Okay, my first thought was, when you're starting with a new and interesting good idea, and you've thought about a lot of the little pieces, there are things that already exist that function quite well. And they do get response times and things like that, immediate response times from medical professionals. And most of it is cardiovascularly related. So that was just my initial thought. Well, if there's stuff here, you know, I can have my Garmin, my heart rate monitor, I know exactly what it is all the time. I don't necessarily need that information transmitted, but it was just a thought that I had that if I wanted to find something, the first thing I do is see what's out there. And if there's already a lot out there, maybe you take the same idea and maybe just sort of head down a different avenue. That's my only thought.
Great presentation, and I really like the idea how it solves a very important problem with your very convenient everyday product. I just have a question when it comes to pricing. Have you considered giving out like a free trial or sample for customers? Because $150 seems to be relatively high price for me.
Yes, so at the start, we would try to give out free trials and try to get as many subscriptions as possible. And in the future, like as long as we can build up our database, it will be easier for and more accessible for people to use. And we can also provide predictions with large subscriptions. So at first, we will start with like free trials. And in the future, we will charge. And the subscription price provided here is just in theory. We haven't like finalized our subscription price yet.
And also, it's $150 for a year, so that's about 12, like more than $10 for every month. And I definitely think that's a reasonable price.
Okay, sounds very interesting. Great
job. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, our next entrepreneur is Aatrox. His mentor is based in Detroit, so hopefully he's on right now listening. Hi, Logan. So I'll introduce Aatrox. Much like our last group of entrepreneurs, Aatrox is taking on a huge challenge in our society, namely the crushing amount of credit card debt that many Americans face every day. And Aatrox has trying to take that on with an interactive mobile solution. So we're going to switch slides, and then we're going to move on to Aatrox. Thank you so much.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Aatrox Wang, and my company is about financial education. I will provide financial education to these people who are in financial illiteracy. Okay, let's start. And basically, it's like a Fitbit of finance. Oops. So first, why do people need Foncrete? Because a huge percentage of Americans are financially illiterate, and that's a catastrophe because they are not aware of the credit card debts and the compound interest. And as Einstein said, compound interest is the most powerful thing in the world. And this thing is currently created up over such numbers. And what my company will do is will provide a fun and simple way to save them from endless credit card debt and compound interest. And now the problem is that I will show you three set of numbers. The first is 15,000. That's an average household debt credit card debt. And if you multiply this number by every family in U.S., it's $729 billion. That's a huge number, right? And also, 45% of young people who could not monthly pay all the debt, that means 45% of them are currently bear the torture of compound interest. And that could create a vicious circle, which is they could get their wage monthly, and they first need to pay for the routine livelihood fees, which is like your money to buy for the food and electricity fees. And some reasons cause the overspending of the remaining money, which is like URC inciting advertisement by Nike, and they are moved and they buy it. So they are getting debt this month, and if they already accumulated credit card debt, they have to pay all the pay for the debt of last month. So the result is that they have less money to manage every month, and this thing is going worse and worse. And credit card companies said, no worries, you have credit cards. And in those financial illiterate people's eyes, credit cards means an infinite number of money. And what my company will do is that Foncrete, an application. I will provide an application for gamified. And easy money management. And also, I will provide a community to exchange ideas, a platform to eliminate financial illiteracy. And also, the whole application is simple and easy to manage. It's like a Fitbit of finance. And for the gamified part is that I will, so what I want to ask the question, what makes a game addictive? Yes. If you win, so it has competition. And secondly, you could create a virtual community in the game. Thus, the game is addictive. If everyone is going to use my application has to also be addictive. So thus, I will create competition in my application and community in that. And more prototype is a mobile application that provides education, conversation, and fun. There are three buttons. The first is money manager. The money manager one is pretty simple. You could only type your Roth income in it and receive and type the money you currently want to get every month. And it will help you to set up a plan for every day, so for everyday use. And the second is findings. I will provide some financially basis to them to teach them basic financial knowledge, and also some informational news, and also the third button is community. People could it's basically like a forum. People could chat in the community and ask questions and read some passages about their own experience. And that's a money manager. You could see your level and your experience point, and it will show you the number that you the number of users in this app that you currently beat, and you could share it with your friends, and that will create competition. And for community, I think I already had it on the community battle. And also about target customers, who is negatively affected by the endless cycle of credit card debt most? Bob. Who is Bob? A young adult just graduated from their college and stepped into society. He tried really hard in schoolworks and he did all the things he could do to improve his GPA, and thus he find a job. But in the college and in the high school, the school will not provide him with basis, with something about finance and economy. Thus, he knew nothing about the credit card and the basis of the finance. He could not manage the money he created, and that's a catastrophe. We have talked about it. And many people between age 22 to 35 are just like him. And the compound interest is accumulating on this group of people. So another question is, do people like it? I've currently asked my older friends about such things. And you could see the rank from 1 to 10, and their average scale is relatively high. And two of the few people who said they don't want this is that they have an absolutely different financial view about their basic finance. Because they think if they could get three times income than their expense, and they could be rich. Well, basically, that's the opposite of my application. So they said no. Well, a very sharp question is that, why should I choose you but not Ming.com or Coursera? I've asked my friends about his view about Coursera or Ming.com. He think the whole managed system of Mint is pretty complicated, and he is in torture of this charge of this whole detailed money management. And what I'm going to do is create a simple way for money management. And people, the only thing people need to do is that type. It's the type the numbers, and they are not worrying about those percentage and those things that make them freak out about the whole thing about the finance. And also, I will create a community that the simple money management application could not provide you, a community that could solve your problem, and people that you could speak with, and they could solve your problem. And I think that's my unique point. So how can I get profit from my company? The list above is my revenue model. In application advertising by loan consolidation companies, financial institutions, and investments for firms, financial consultants, etc. And about this, I think this could benefit three of us. For me, I could get profit, and for those companies, they could advertise themselves and get potential customers. And for my customers, they could find a way to get through this credit card debt or have a better money management. So where is my revenue model? Look at the Twitter or Instagram on your phone. My company's value is based on the amount of users I have, just as them. So that's my revenue model. And my expense model is $2,000 for creating first version of the application, and another $2,000 for the server and maintenance cost every year. That's fair. And my only ask is, let this adventure start. And thank you. Special thanks for Mr. Gorganti and Mr. Kelly, who supported me with data. And actually, the games file idea is proposed by Mr. Gorganti. Thanks.
So I want to compliment you on your presentation. Financial literacy is something that's very, very important, and we saw from your statistics that clearly a lot of Americans are in considerable debt. I think gaming as a way to educate people is a fantastic way to go, something we promote at the university that I'm with. I do have a question, however, about the actual game itself. A lot of people consider their finances to be very personal. So the amount of money that I were to save as a variable in a game that I'm playing against other people, I might have a level of discomfort with that. So how would you work around to continue to have it be a game, but maybe not necessarily use as someone's personal financials as a way to increase performance in the game?
Well, the point is that my application will not show show your financial condition. It will only show how much money you saved or the percentage you have saved. And also, my game will show the level. It's based on level, and people could upgrade and show off their level, but not their financial conditions.
Okay.
So my question has to deal with, I think I understood that the idea was that advertising is the main revenue stream. Is that right?
Yes.
And advertising requires a certain amount of scale, a certain amount of people, even some of the potential companies that would advertise that you pointed out need quite a bit of scale to be able to spend money on you as one of their choices of where they spend their advertising dollars.
Yes.
I'm assuming that you build a great application, that it's engaging, that people like it, that they use it. But how do you get the number of people up to the level that advertisers would be interested in spending their money with you?
Well, the thing is that, after an enough amount of time, people, my users will be accumulated to a great amount, and I could solve many of them's money problems, their financial management. And thus I will propose some this special group of people. I will propose this this advertisement to them, and thus they could see if they want us. And I think this whole thing is free, and also my value is based on the amount of my users. So so about the advertisements, it's about users thing, the amount of them.
Mm-hmm. Aatrox, I think you're dealing with a very important problem, so I compliment you trying to address it. Mm-hmm. You got to help me here, though. I've been trying to figure this out. How did you come up with this name? What does it mean?
What?
Foncrete.
Foncrete. It's basically like my microfinance, like concrete. It's hard, it's stable.
Like concrete?
Yes, concrete.
Well, why wouldn't it be Fincrete then?
Foncrete?
Finance.
Because it's easier to think if you think it's Foncrete but not Fincrete.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, so I've had the good pleasure of mentoring Luna and Gordon. I first learned about their idea when I accidentally came in to talk to Mr. Glassman and Ms. Stokes, and they shared some of the ideas that were submitted, and I fell in love with the idea. And as they both advised me, they said that I would fall in love with them even more, and that is the case. So I know we're a little short on time. I'm going to turn it over to them and let them show you what they're made of.
I'm Luna.
And I'm Gordon.
And we're Magic Wabbit. We're both many years from getting our driver's license, so it's pretty ironic that we're creating a service surrounding cars. However, we both have one common interest. Not interest, but like similarity. We both hate waiting in lines with our families to get our car washed. It's not only inconvenient, but it's very time consuming.
And that's how we came up with Magic Wabbit.
Well, what is Magic Wabbit?
Magic Wabbit is a car cleaning service that comes to you where you work. And the best part about it is that it's 100% waterless.
Initially, our target customers were nursing home residents. However, when we came in contact with several nursing homes, they informed us that many of the residents there didn't even own cars and were not allowed to. So we had to go on a new route. So we thought that doctors and nurses at suburban hospitals would be the best target customer for us. Since they have up to a 12-hour workday, they're very stationary, and with their good income, they're able to afford our service on a regular basis.
We washed two cars. The first thing that we did was we vacuumed the inside, and then we used a spray-on wax on the outside, and we used a cloth to wipe up all the dirt as a substitute for water. One of the owners of the car said, "I also liked how shiny my car was in the weeks after. It liked it out of protective wax." It's worth mentioning that the owner of her car keeps her car in an urban environment without any protection. So, yeah.
So here's a chart of the projected gains that we will have that our business will acquire. So including all the expenses and the labor, we will have a profit of $18.59 per car if we charge $36 a car wash.
This is what that chart looks like on a larger scale. For you to wash, say, 20 cars a week, every week, for a year, we would make around $36,000, and we would profit around $18,000. Now, if you were to, say, wash 500 cars a week, every week, for a year, we would be making $900,000, and we would profit around $450,000.
So our competitors, both indirect and direct, include Spiffy, Car Concierge, and two local car washes in Chestnut Hill. Spiffy and Car Concierge are our main direct competitors because they are both on-call mobile car washes, just as Magic Wabbit is. However, what makes us different is that we are waterless and we go directly to your place of work rather than your house. So this is a benefit because you're able to do your job as well as get something on your to-do list checked off.
We surveyed 12 doctors who work at Jefferson Hospital in the city, and we found out that nearly half of them use public transportation to go in and out of work. That helped us decide to move to suburban hospitals, like Chestnut Hill Hospital, for instance.
So this is the part of the presentation where we ask for a loan. However, we're not asking for an investment. We just need customers for our business to start up. Thank you. Any questions?
Good job, guys. What products are you using to clean the cars with?
Well, here we have a window cleaner. It's you use this on the mirrors and you use it on the lights. Here you have the interior cleaner, which you would spray on like the center console. Then here we have the exterior wash, which is a spray-on wax that you would spray on like the door of your car, and then you would use these cloths to wash all of it, and it would these pick up all the dirt.
And so, what was your what was your observation of how well, you know, I know you had one customer that liked it, but, you know, what are the challenges that you guys saw?
Well, for me, it was washing a car for the first time, so we had to read all the instructions and the labels that the bottles gave us, and it took us about an hour and a half, which seems like a long time, but that's also for two people who have never washed a car before in their life.
Well, I think it's a great idea. I think you were inspired probably by a lot of these on-demand services, whether it's dry cleaning or getting a ride somewhere. There's so many of them today, right? TaskRabbit and things like that. And I'm sure you found them when you were doing your competitive research. The real question for that is, though, how do you get the... You guys said you weren't driving yet, so I assume you're busy during the day, right?
Mm-hmm.
With school, and you will be for a couple of years. So how would you recruit the people that you need to be able to do this, right? And then I have some questions. I just want to ask the follow-up on that on price, because I think you might be off a little bit there, because the cost of the cleaning materials, you also have to get someone to get to the place and back. It's a good amount of time. So I'm just looking at your gross profit, which I think was how much per car? $36 minus what was your expenses? 18 a car. Mm-hmm. So my question is, have you really thought enough about the expense of someone going to the location and then they have to get back, the gas and time to do that, the materials that you have? And how would you find the people that would be willing to do that? Because a business like this, just like an Uber or so many of these other on-demand services, require lots and lots of people.
Okay, thank you. That's a great question. I think that we're just going to send out, like, as a normal job would, a sign-up sheet, and you would have to, we would like a normal interview, and that's how we would get recruits for our business. And also, I think that we need to definitely expand more on the expenses, because all we have is the materials and the labor, so we're paying $15 an hour for each worker. And I just think that we need to put in, like you said, the specific details of transportation and specifics.
A follow-up question too. You said you don't do that. You would do it at the job site, but mm-hmm. not residential. But why?
Well, in response to your first question, originally we thought we might do like it'd be signed up by like say the hospital itself. But then we realized we might have to go through too much paperwork to get there. So in response to your second question, what was your second question, Ann? Sorry. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, we can meet afterwards and talk.
I do think there's a lot of people out here who would love to be able to push a button on their phone and have their car.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Just on the actual cleaning process, I know I personally use like a wash and wax solution if I'm doing my car. If I don't bring it to a car wash. Typically, the car's rinsed first with water to remove a certain level of dirt or so. Do you have a sense of what might happen to the paint job if you don't use water and just use the wax solution?
Thank you very much for that question. We were taught by our mentor and Ms. Stokes that if there was dirt on the car or like any other residue, or if the cloth touched the ground and had dirt on it, it would scratch the car and ruin the paint job. So what we did was wipe wipe off like with just a dry cloth so everything was smooth and there was no dirt or rocks or anything. And so we made sure that that wouldn't ruin the paint job. Sorry, here I am again. We also created sign-up sheets, so if you guys are interested in being one of our first customers, we are going to be in the back, and we have sign-up sheets ready for you. Thank you.
Hi, I'm pleased to introduce Simon Nong. Simon is in his first year at SCH. He heard about the Venture Incubator and jumped in with both feet. I think he has a really potentially viable enterprise here. They say that the thing that motivates entrepreneurs is either that something is not working the way they want it to work, so they create something that satisfies their needs, or they see something that can be improved. And I think in Simon's case, both of these things are at work in his project. So look forward to hearing about it.
Oh, I can't wait. I was waiting for this moment for past 9 weeks, and finally I'm here. So good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Simon Ong. And the name of my business is iVisit. So what is iVisit? iVisit is a website that gives the widest and most subjective information about American private high schools. And we also provide a video tour to each school that is made by the students. And our target customers are the international students and the parents. So before telling you what we have, let me introduce you the perspective of an international student to search for a U.S. high school. There's a lot of problems. First, there's 33,000 private high schools, but only 10% of them accept international students. And second, there's a lot of incorrect information, such as the untrustworthy agency I have suffered from. They lied to me because they cooperate with the schools, and they just recommend the best schools to me. That's what I don't want to happen. And second, there's a lot of incorrect information online, and that's a very, very important and serious problem. And last, the process application is very, very confusing. So here's an example. So this information is from my biggest and only competitor, which is findingschool.com. There are also a website that provides the information about American private high schools. And I just want to test their accuracy, and what I found really, really shocked me. I pressed SCH in, and what I got is Chestnut Hill Academy still exists, which we all know it doesn't exist a long time ago, right? And second, in a category, SCH Academy is a boys' school. Wow. It means we lost a lot of potential girl students every year. It's a pity for students that we lost a international student friend, and she might even be the president of the student council. And also, it's a pity for the schools because they lost a full-pay student. So let me tell you what we have. First, we have updated database. Second, we have anonymous comments. Third, we have forums and for the parents and the students. And last, we have student-created videos. So first, we have updated confirmed information. It's actually a win-win cooperation with the schools, which means we provide advertisement places for the schools, and the only thing they need to give us is the newest information. And anonymous comments. So how many of you guys have ever used Amazon or eBay before? Please raise your hands. Thank you very much. Amazon. My mom asked me to buy a lot of stuff for her, so I use a lot. And a thing I always do before buying products is to read the reviews. Why? I think it's because it is the comments that people gave after using the real products. So here's a statistics I heard. So 83% of the Amazon customers put the reviews in a priority place. And some people may ask me, you're a new company, how you get our comments? And my solution is I'll collect all the comments from the agency first. And second, I will also use the social media, such as Facebook and Twitter. And last, when eventually I form my circle, I have my own customers, they can give me the comments. And third, the forums. We'll provide the parent forum and the student forum. Some people may ask me, why you have two forums? Just have one. But I think it's very important because I want to keep privacy for the students. For example, I'm a high school student and I'm having trouble in making friends in American private high schools. So I just want to ask the people who has been here for a long time how you solve the culture shock problem. But I don't really want my parents to know their kids is having trouble in making friends. So they can talk free in the forum, but the forums will still be monitored, which means illegal things will not be happening in our forums. And we also provide a forum for the parents, because Chinese parents love talking about their kids. So here's the platform. And last, it's the student create videos. So basically, the videos is made by the student in each school. And it's the school's responsibility to ask their student to make the videos. They can give them extra credit or put it as a task. It's their responsibilities. And the student will gain a share of profit based on the number of the views. So me, as a student in SH, I'm very proud of my school. So I made a prototype for our school. Let's take a look. Basically, that's it. It's a 5 minutes video, and if you want to see the full one, you can search it a day in SCH in YouTube. And before making this video, I knew nothing about making videos, and I just spent 2 weeks to figure it out. So it's totally doable for students to make videos. And then let's take a look at the market potential. So here's a chart for the number of Chinese students in American private high schools. Can you even imagine? 7 years before, there's only 65 Chinese students in America. That's a total. And right now, the number is 53,000. It's 824 times as 7 years before. And it started to grow stably since 2012 with a rate of 31% per year. It's a huge amount, and the scientists call it the floating market because it's really crazy. It never happens before. And what is good news is the day school just started to accept the new international students since 2012. And here is the marketing plan. So basically, at first, it's a win-win cooperation with the schools and agencies, which means we provide an advertisement for the schools and they give me the information. And we'll let customers of the agencies use my website, and after they, their customers using that, it's a word-of-the-mouth marketing. And last, I'll also use social media to advertise myself. And here's the business plan. We'll have a subscribe system, which means after a 30-day trial, we charge our customers $4.99 per month to access to some part of our website. And our goal is to have 500 subscribers in a year, which means we'll eventually earn $2,500 per month. And second, we also have advertisements for the schools and testing agencies. So we hope to earn $500 in a year, which means we'll eventually earn $3,000 a month. So what is our advantage? First, we have accuracy. Second, we have vicarious experience, which is provided by the videos. And third, we have stickiness, which means the students and the parents will still continually visit my website because of the forums and the comments. And we still have a huge market of the day school, which, because our only competitor, findingschool.com, they are now focused on the boarding school. And last, we have a well-designed website. Please raise your hand if you think a website full of creative videos, pictures, and forums is better than a website full of words. Thank you so much. Here's Finding School. Confusing. Words. And here's iVisit. We have pictures, we have helpful tips for the students, and we also have the forums, the videos. So it's much better, huh? And here we go. It's a plan for the next 6 months. First, I'll create my own website first. And second, I start to outreach the schools, and start from PA. And third, it's the agency outreach, which means I start to advertise myself. And last, when your firms are circle, I start to expand area. And the budget for 6 months will be $2,000 to $3,000. And what I need, I'm now still looking for the technology support because I know nothing about website creating and maintaining, so I'm now looking for a technology support. And second, I'm still looking for investment for the first 6 months. So if you are interested in my business, please contact me after a presentation. So I'm Simon Ong, and the reason I'm here is because I really want the students to have a very wonderful journey to be here. It's my dream to study in the American high school, and the application process should be fun. So I don't want them to suffer like what I did. So I really wish them to have a good journey. And iVisit is a potential business that can make a dream work. Thank you so much for listening. And I have to give my special thanks to Ms. Stokes, Mr. Glassman, and my best mentor, Ms. Lingard. So 9 weeks ago, my business is not like this. It's just a little seed, and it was not complete. And after 9 weeks, it grows like a big, big tree, like a giant tree. Thank you so much for helping. And also, I have to say thank you to my CLVI families, because in the past 9 weeks, we support each other, we help each other, we give each other feedbacks. I love you so much, guys. Thank you.
Any questions? Yeah, we got a bunch. Let's start with Fred.
Nice presentation, great idea.
Thank you.
I wish your website was out 3 years ago, so I could have used it. I just have a question. Like the video you shown, right, it made SCH look very good.
Yep.
And you said it's a win-win situation for both the school and you, right, for the school to promote their information and for you to obtain the information.
Yes.
What if the school, you know, puts on fake information on a website? Who is going to do the quality check for you?
We will have somebody to check the quality, and yes, that's a very good question. And
we will have some technology support to check the quality the student, the school gave us. And if we found that the schools use the fake information, the whole market will know that everybody in China will know, everybody use iVisit will know they use fake information. And they are, if they provide the fake information, they are breaking their own market. So I believe the schools will not do this kind of things.
Sounds good.
Thank you.
Hi.
Hi.
Couple quick questions. How did you determine your startup costs? Like you had your 6-month plan.
Yes.
And your startup costs.
Good question. So the mainly cost will be the website design, because I don't know how to design a website and it has to be professional. So I will ask somebody to design a website. And when I did some research and the fee will be like $1,000. And there are some other things about the website, such as the domain name buying, the copyrights, and
well, that's
also
not expensive. But the website, if you have someone that's going to do it for $1,000, I need their name too. I'm just kidding. It's okay. Very inexpensive for a website unless you can get someone to donate.
Yes.
The domain names aren't expensive.
Yes.
Most of the time. How about your monthly charge, $4.99?
$4.99.
How did you come up with that number?
So there's a another website, they also charge for watching the videos.
Sure.
So they charge $8.99 to watch free videos around America. So I think I can't charge that much because it's actually a balance. So if I charge too much, the parents and students were not willing to use my website. So actually the exchange of $4.99 into the RMB, the Chinese dollars, will be 30. So 30 days for $30, so I think it will be more even. And mainly the websites usually just charge 30 Chinese dollars for their customers.
Okay, great. I appreciate your energy and your passion. Very
Thank
good.
You.
Well, I think I know the three of us have sat in on many of these. I have two things I do want to say to you. One, the passion is unbelievable. And
Thank
two,
you.
This actually is a problem. There's parts of the school that have been looking at the opportunity, because getting international students here, and you did mention something, and it's uncomfortable sometimes to talk about, but mm-hmm. most international students are full pay. And they bring something to the school that educates everybody around here from
yes.
a more global perspective. And so it's great for the schools that actually do it. And so I just want to say, I think you identified a big problem. This is a huge growing market. Just do the math on the 50,000. Multiply it by the 30,000 probably average there is a year. It's $150 million and growing extremely quick market. And there's not a lot of competition, so it's the Wild West. So you grab your territory and do it. So I would just encourage you, more than anyone that I've ever seen do it, do this. Really do this.
Yes.
And make it happen. I think you really could. And then secondly, I've been on the media side of business. I've created a magazine, which was an internet business, and sold it. And so I always had that idea of, is it subscription or is it viewership? And by the way, I can tell you that even schools like this are very interested in growing our international program. So we would spend money to help advertise and market on the site. And so I think just capturing as many eyeballs of the right audience of people in different countries looking at the U.S. for school is probably a much bigger opportunity. And you probably limit yourself by going the subscription route, right? So I think you really want to consider whether it's a free model for consumers and the schools will advertise, or whether there's some sort of freemium type thing, if you've heard of that, right? So some stuff is free, some stuff you pay extra for, maybe the
yes.
application process. Mm-hmm.
Thank you so much.
I have two questions. I'm wondering if you can demonstrate any more enthusiasm for this than you have. and secondly, I'm interested in the way you've sequenced it. I heard you say you want to start in Pennsylvania, but
yes.
I don't imagine that potential high school students or their parents in China think of Pennsylvania first. They may think of small schools or schools in cold areas or maybe coastal schools. So I just wonder whether there's not a better starting mechanism that attracts more people that have a central interest rather than just Pennsylvania.
Yes. Yeah, so basically what I will do is I'll start from Pennsylvania and start to expand from East Coast and then West Coast. And in that kind of process, I will also, for example, in the first 6 months, I will also get some information about the top 100 schools in all around America. So actually the top 100 schools is the top choice for the parents. So they're the most famous one. So I will get the most famous one done, and also I will expand from PA.
Why wouldn't you go to the most famous one first and not go to PA? And, I mean, I'm suggesting not go to PA mm-hmm. as the starting thing, because in China, mm-hmm. you wouldn't necessarily be looking for schools in PA. You've still got the problem comparing PA with other schools.
Yes. That's a good idea. I would think about it. And I think maybe the main concern, I really want to do that, but actually, I think it's the budget problem, because our company is a new company and we don't actually have a lot of budget. So.
Oh, I understand that. I agree. You ought to start small and then grow it. The question is what you start small with.
Yes.
Understand?
Yep.
Good.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Great job.
Thank you.
Okay, almost to the finish line. We have two presentations left to go. Thank you to everyone in our audience for sticking with us. Thank you, judges, for the wonderful questions. I'm going to introduce Daniel and Amy to take the stage next. Their mentor is also remote. So if you're listening, hi, crew. Hope you're enjoying this. I'm really excited to hear their presentation, Spotlight Sponsors. So without further ado, why don't you guys take the stage? Daniel and Amy.
Hi, my name is Daniel.
And I'm Amy.
So imagine that you are the head of the robotics club in high school. You need more money to keep this club running. So what are you going to do? So maybe you want to go to a crowdfunding website, or you may want to ask the parents to donate, or you even want to use your own money. Today we're going to show you a better way to solve this problem. Our company is called Spotlight Sponsors. It's a platform that helps school clubs and sport teams to fund local small businesses as sponsors. So basically, the small business gives money to the clubs and the teams sell their naming rights or put some advertisement on their t-shirt as a return.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Say you are a store owner on Germantown Avenue. You want other people to know your store, but you have a limited amount of money. You can sponsor a local school team. And so now you want to sponsor a local school sport team. You may not know the detailed information of the team, like whether this team needs a sponsor or how much money this team will need. Also, as a member of the community, sometimes you may have no idea of how to do contribution to this community. As members in school clubs and sport teams, a better financial support means a better experience. Yeah.
And we have done some research among the clubs and sports teams, and over 70% of them, they said they need money from the sponsors. And these are two specific quotes we found really useful for our project. The first one is from the Marine Science Club, and they said that they're using their own monies to purchase their supplies. And this showed the need of the sponsors and how much they are contributing to this program. And the next one is from the Robotics Club. They're needing $50,000 each year for their materials, tools, and electronics. That shows like how important that sponsors are to the robotics teams to make sure their competitions are going right. And these are the business researches. Most of the businesses said they are doing sponsoring and on the sports teams and clubs. And they said that they consider the sponsoring as both marketing and contribution to the society. And the second is a specific example of how much they need for sponsoring a club or team.
Let's take a look at our target market. So currently we are aiming to develop a mature business model here in Philadelphia with local businesses and school clubs and sport teams. As you can see, this is the market size of our business. There are 151 high schools in Philadelphia and lots of local businesses. So after develop a mature business model in Philadelphia, we are aiming to grow big and expand our business throughout the United States. And if given the right opportunities, we would be willing to expand our business throughout the world.
And this is our solution. Our solution is to make a website that has three steps. The first step is the sports teams go on our website and log in their informations. And the second step would be sponsors searching the teams based on their locations and other aspects to find the most suitable teams. And the third step would be sponsors giving money to the sports teams. And also, we are going to try to protect the rights of both sides. And this is our prototype. And I'm going to lead you through our prototype. And then say that you're a sponsor. You need to sign up first in your prototype. You click sign up and then click I am a sponsor. And then fill out your informations. And then say that you're an individual and then put in your address. Click next. And then select your payment method or just click add later. And then this is our homepage of our website. And then you can see the top rated teams and clubs. And also you can search the clubs and teams based on your location. And then these are our suggestions based on your search. And if you click on one of these club photos, you can see more specific information. That's not our presentation. No. Sorry. And then it's our direct competitors. Our direct competitors are the peer.com and the piggyback.com. The peer.com is a website that's club-based. Club-based means it's basically clubs go on their websites and find their sponsors. And that would be the exact opposite for our website. And the piggyback.com is a crowdfunding website that's mainly sports teams giving small presents to the sponsors. But they don't give the store owners enough reputation increase. And our indirect competitors would be the school websites and the crowdfunding websites. The school websites only provide the contact of the school, but not necessarily the specific information of the clubs and sports teams, if they need money or not, and also other more specific information. And the crowdfunding websites are focusing mainly on the small projects and ideas. So that would be a totally different area.
So our website is a sponsor-based website. That means most visitors of our website will be sponsors. And we build a website based on their need. What's also special with our business is that we promote a coherence in a small area. Like, we encourage the schools and the business to work together and provide a win-win solution for both sides. At the end of the day, our business is going to help the school and the business to form a mutual beneficial relationship. Here are some costs of our business. We need to build a website, we need to maintain it, and last but not least, we have to do some marketing. There are mainly two ways how we are going to make money. We are going to charge a fee on the sponsors for each transaction that's happening on our website. and our website is a great resource for advertisement. There are 151 high schools in Philadelphia, and if we assume that at least each school has 10 clubs or teams each year, that would be 1,510 clubs and teams. If we assume that 20% of them would use our website and find a sponsor, and each transaction is about $200, and every day there are around 10,000 visitors of our website, that will make us around $10,000. As there are about 37,000 high schools in the US, that will make us a total $2.5 million.
And we're asking for our starting money for website building and website maintenance, and that would be about $4,000 in total, for $3,000 for building and $1,000 for maintaining. And we are giving our special thanks to Mr. Drew, our mentor, and Mr. Glassman and Ms. Stokes. And thank you.
Hi, guys. I think that was a pretty good presentation and a very good idea, so I'd just like to say thank you for that. And I would also like to know how you guys are better than the other competitors that you listed before.
Thank you for your question. And I consider our website as a more easier solution to the than other websites.
So like one of our core value would be localized. So our website is a localized website. One of its goals is to really build a community. So it's like to let the local business know the school teams and let the school teams know the local business and like let them work together and create a win-win solution. Yeah, that's our core value.
Good job, guys. During these last 9 weeks, what did you find was the largest challenge?
So as you may know that most of the clubs would love to have the sponsor to give them money. But on the other hand, the local businesses sometimes would consider the social media as a better way for marketing. So we are going to prove them that sponsoring a local team can also be a way of marketing, and this may have a better effect. Yeah. So this is the challenge for now.
And what did you learn? What did you learn during these 9 weeks about yourself? Tough question.
So,
did you have fun?
Yeah.
It was hard, right?
Yeah, it's pretty hard. Like, go out and ask the business to answer your questions. But it's a great experience, and you know how to talk to different kind of people. Like, it's easier to talk to your classmates who are the heads of the club, but it is more difficult to talk to the store owners.
Thank you for the great presentation. I just have a quick question of how you're going to secure your information online. How are you going to ensure that all the transactions happen on your website, but you know, not under the table transactions? Because you already stated that you provide information for the school teams.
Choosing our website has two benefits. First of all, our website doesn't show the like all the information at our results page. Like, it doesn't show the school name, so it's really hard for you to know which club or which team, which school this team belongs to. Also, our website protects the rights of the sponsors. Like, if you give some money to a local school sport team and the school team doesn't do the work, like, it doesn't do what it has promised, like, you have nothing to do with it. Yeah, thank you.
Well, I'd like to think we've saved the best for last. Mindy and I had the pleasure of working with these two girls who have a fantastic idea that is, I've mentored, I don't know how many times, 5 or 6, I feel like, and this one is the closest to actually happening for me, and we're excited to be part of it.
I would just say that it's been a great afternoon, and this is a simple idea that everyone can relate to, and the girls have been passionate and enthusiastic, and I think you'll enjoy this very much. Sophie and Paige.
Babysitting has been around forever. Everybody knows it's a successful idea. We saw modernization missing among the communication, scheduling, and even just finding the babysitters.
We saw a way where we could modernize this traditional system and adapt it to our own community. In the fall, we created Babysitting Club, and we saw a potential business opportunity where we could educate, which would allow us to train and educate potential babysitters.
We decided to take that opportunity and join Venture Incubator. We are excited to introduce SitterBook, the ideal solution for parents who need babysitters and students who need connections.
SitterBook is a website platform where parents can find reliable, qualified, and dedicated babysitters from their own trustworthy school community. Some problems we noticed in the community was when one teacher expressed to us that she was tired of having to refer SCH lower school parents to potential upper school babysitters. Paige, how does SitterBook fix that problem?
SitterBook solves that problem because now parents can easily browse babysitters from their community without having to contact anyone.
Another problem we noticed was when one of our friends expressed to us that she struggled to find babysitting jobs since she lived in Center City. Paige, how does SitterBook solve that problem?
SitterBook solves that problem because babysitters can get jobs super easily by just being on the website.
Another one we noticed was when we were interviewing some parents, one of the parents expressed to us that she had tried to use care.com, but she felt very uncomfortable having someone that she didn't know watch her kids. Paige, how does SitterBook solve that problem?
SitterBook solves that problem because now parents have a way of viewing all of the babysitter's qualifications from their own community.
Our first and foremost competition is people who already have babysitters or have someone that could refer them to babysitters.
Our second biggest competitor is care.com, which most of you probably know about. It's a babysitting and caregiving website which lists babysitters and caregivers near you. A problem with care.com is that you have to be 18 or older to sign up to be a babysitter. Another competitor we have is Sitter, which is an app which is almost exactly like care.com. It shows babysitters which are near you. We are better than those because all of those are open communities. Anyone can join. Anyone can say they're a babysitter if they're over 18. With us, it's a closed community. The parents know that these babysitters are coming from their school, and they know exactly where they're coming from.
And we also provide the training for the babysitters. So this is our prototype. It's a website. And when you go on, you'll see the homepage, which will have, so if you're a parent, you'll select find a sitter, and be a sitter is to come later. And then you scroll down and you'll see our featured sitters. So they'll be based off how reliable they are, which will be based off of the parents rating them after they sit for their kids. And then also how often they get booked.
So I'm going to run you through the website quickly if you are a parent looking for a babysitter. So you can click more info and it will bring you to my profile, which it will tell you everything you need to know about me. It tells you the age, the grade, experience with kids, and interests, which is important because when we were talking to parents, they said that they would want to know the interests of the babysitter so they could match them up perfectly with their child. It also shows if I am willing to give homework help, if I can drive, other certifications, and reliability points, which other parents who have used this babysitter rate the babysitters. We also give a suggested price based on all of the babysitter's qualifications and reliability points. The parents aren't required to pay the babysitter that price. It's just a suggestion. We also give them a
radius which the babysitter is willing to go to, so the parent can check if they're in that radius. So if you wanted a babysitter for Wednesday, you could click book now and a notification would be sent to me where I would get a verification code and confirm that on the website. Once the babysitter has confirmed the job, the parent will pay a service fee to SitterBook, and then after they pay that service fee, a direct message will open up on the website through the parent and the babysitter.
So our website targets two groups of people, the first being parents to go on and actively be booking sitters, and the second is students to be dedicated members of the club, which is where we will be training our sitters and where we'll be getting sitters to babysit. And also, parents will be our source of income, which will provide us with the money that we need to cover our admissions fees. So Paige, why is SitterBook better?
SitterBook is better because we are strictly a closed community. All of the other websites, which I mentioned before, are open communities. It's super easy to fake your qualifications. We're a closed community, which makes us trustworthy. The parents can trust that they are getting good babysitters from their own community. They know exactly where they're coming from, and they know that it's all truthful.
So our babysitters are reliable and qualified because they've gone through the training, which the club requires them to go through to be on the website. They are taught what to do in every scenario that could go wrong, from when they pick up the child from school to when the child goes to bed. And they're dedicated because they put in a lot of time to the club. We require them to come to all club meetings, and if they fail to do that, they won't be put on the website. We had a focus group with some parents from the community, and one of the moms said, "I would rather have a babysitter from my school. My kids would be so excited to have someone to look up to."
When we were talking to the parents, we also asked them how much they would be willing to pay to view the babysitters from their community, schedule, and book them right there under 10 minutes. They said if it was a super busy month, they would want to pay an upfront monthly subscription for unlimited bookings, and that's $12. Or if they only had one or two things to do that month, then they would only want to pay a $4 per booking fee. And that money goes to SitterBook. We stay out of the communication and transaction of the parents and the babysitters. Here are financial projections for year one for one school. We have almost $2,000 in income, and that comes from 120 monthly subscriptions for the whole entire year and 120 booking fees for the whole entire year. We also have $360 in expenses, and that is mostly going towards our hosting service, which is where we build our website. Some of it also goes towards domain name, a bank account for SitterBook, and also a payment transaction fee, which we are required to pay because we are transacting money on our website. SitterBook's next steps are to first build our full and final website. We are also looking for a designer and developer to help us do so. We're also looking for investors to help us pay for associated costs, which we just talked about.
Also, we're looking for parents to sign up to be a part of a free trial. And if you're interested, to test out the website and refine all the kinks. So if you're interested in signing up, you can click this link in our presentation, and it'll take you to a page, and we'll be sure to email you when our website is up and running.
We are so much more than just a booking platform.
We provide the training that is necessary to become a reliable, qualified, and dedicated babysitter.
Thank you.
Should we say thank you? We would also like to thank Mindy and Ms. Norton for helping us through the whole process.
And also Mr. Glassman and Ms. Stokes for helping us through every single problem, because trust us, there were a lot.
Any questions? Sorry.
Hi, okay. So since most of your revenue is coming directly from the parents subscribing or paying per booking, I was wondering what stops the parents from just going directly to the sitters since you already have their names and you know what school they go to.
Thank you for asking. We actually have a slide for that question.
So it all starts with how we teach our babysitters, and we teach them how to talk to the parents. So we teach the babysitters, if a parent asks them, hey, are you available to babysit on Friday? The babysitter responds, I don't know, but my availability is on the website. You can check there. So then they're
redirected to the website.
Yeah.
Also, we guarantee the sitters that they'll have more jobs if they stay on the website because they'll have more of a customer base and more parents will be able to look at their profiles rather than only having one parent text you. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So, I think that was a fantastic presentation and also something that easily could be real and very soon. So I have another question for you. You're both in what grade?
Juniors.
So we saw a couple of years ago a really great presentation by girls that had an idea of Friday night babysitting club here in Chestnut Hill at the school. Do you remember that? And do you know what happened? They graduated. So my question is, how do you do, like in any business that you're ever a part of, the big thing is continuity. How can the business do great even when I'm gone? I assume you guys are both going to go to great colleges. So how does something like this, have you thought about, because I believe you could make this happen, last beyond you? You know?
Well, in the club, there are a lot of freshmen that signed up. They make up the majority of probably like over half of the club. And I'm sure many of them would be very interested in taking over the club after we graduated. We just haven't really thought about that yet, but that's definitely something that we would want to think about.
Okay, great job, girls. Please stay on the stage for a second. Can I ask all of our entrepreneurs to join us up front on the stage? So while they're coming up here, I really want to thank our panel of judges, our amazing mentors, Ms. Stokes, my partner in all things CEL, thank you so much for all of your great work this season. But finally and most importantly, I got to thank all of these wonderful entrepreneurs who gave their presentations tonight. In our very first meeting, I described this program as the starting line. So you're seeing what hopefully is just the beginning of real ventures. And I hope to continue to work with many of you as we take these plans and actually launch them. But we're so proud of you, all your hard work. It's really paid off. And congratulations once again. Okay, that's it. Thanks for your time tonight. Thanks for sticking with us. Have a wonderful night.